Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for being here today. I'm really excited. This is going to be a great panel discussion we've got planned here. Just before we get into the panel discussion, I want to introduce myself. I'm Julia Santor. I'm the county's workforce housing planner. And I'm going to do a brief introduction to what workforce housing is. What is workforce housing and why do we need it? Workforce housing is housing generally for anyone working in a low to moderate wage job who may have a hard time finding stable housing that they can afford. And these could be people, anyone in retail, the restaurants you might visit, maybe teachers or teachers' assistants, possibly even civil servants like firefighters or policemen. If you take a look at the map up above, up here, this is renter cost burden across the entire state. Oh, it's a little bit hard to see. Is that? Nope. That one. Okay, sorry. So that's New Hanover County, you can see us down here in the corner. We're kind of a light orange. The lighter colors indicate fewer cost burdened households in that county, and then the darker colors indicate more cost burdened households in that county as a percentage of total renter households. When we talk about cost burden, for people who may not be aware, it's typically people who are spending more than 30% of their total household income for housing. And this is important because it leaves not a lot of money left over for other necessities like food, medicine, clothing, things like that. So in New Hanover County, about 45% of our renters are cost burdened, and about 24% of our owners are cost burdened. So to put that in perspective for you all, the state as a whole, 44% of renters are cost burdened, and 21% of owners are cost burdened. And for the country as a whole, all of USA, 47% of renters are cost burdened, and 24% of owners are cost burdened. So in New Hanover County, 24% of owners are cost burdened. And we are going to have time for questions at the end, so just to let you know, just hold your questions. So where are we right now? The county and the city recently agreed to establish a permanent workforce housing advisory committee. So that committee, we're hoping to have the first meeting sometime early fall. The county also appointed me as the workforce housing staff liaison. So I'll be working with that committee to work on housing policies and programs. The county has also funded water and sewer infrastructure to 27 new workforce housing homes that are being built by Cape Fear Habitat for Humanity along Daniel Boone Trail up in the Gordon Road area. And then the county is also working to donate our vacant unused land to nonprofits in the community that are going to be building more workforce housing. And lastly, we also are helping victims of Hurricane Florence whose houses may have been severely flooded to apply for grants to have their homes elevated up out of the floodplain. And what this does is it protects those houses from future storms, and it helps us retain some of our naturally occurring affordable housing. So where are we going next? We are going to have that that committee form, and they're going to be working on a comprehensive housing study for New Hanover County and the city of Wilmington, a public opinion survey, and a awareness campaign. And this study is important because it'll be the first of its kind done jointly between the city and the county, and it'll give us a snapshot of the current housing stock. What do we have now, and what do we need? And then it's going to provide some recommendations to bridge that gap between what we've got and what we really need still. And then the survey will be a statistically significant survey kind of to gauge the public's perception of workforce and affordable housing and to ask them, what do you think we need to be doing about this? And then finally, the awareness campaign is just going to be taking data from the study and making sure the public is aware and just notifying people about the key findings from that study. And finally, before we move on to the panelists, I wanted to make people aware of some of the services that the county provides. One is the Water and Sewer Revolving Loan Program provided through the Planning Department. This is a 0% interest loan for anyone who is moderate to low income and may need help either connecting to CFPUA water and sewer or needs to make some important plumbing repairs to their home. And then the Department of Social Services has a few programs as well. They have a low income energy assistance program. This provides a one-time payment of an energy bill between the months of December and March for low-income households. And then water bill assistance is kind of similar, a one-time payment of a water bill for people who might be in crisis situation, can't pay it. And then the in-home aid is where someone will come and help an individual who's either a senior or maybe disabled, help them perform some small house management tasks and maybe help them with shopping and transportation. The North Carolina Housing Finance Agency also has some programs available to potential home buyers. The first one is a down payment assistance program, and this can provide up to $8,000 to a potential home buyer. And it's a forgivable down payment assistance, so if you stay in the home for 15 years, you don't have to pay it back. And then the tax credit is up to $2,000 a year on your federal taxes with that program. So, without further ado, I'd just like to welcome our panelists here today. We have Steve Spain, who is the Executive Director of Cape Fear Habitat for Humanity, and he has 2 decades of experience in affordable housing and homelessness. We have Stephanie Norris, who is a local affordable housing developer, and she utilizes the low-income housing tax credits to create multifamily housing throughout North Carolina and also, of course, here in New Hanover County. And then we also have Dave Spetrino, who is the founder and president of PBC Design and Build, a local home building firm here in Wilmington. And his recent civic involvement includes serving as the immediate past president of Cape Fear Home Builders Association and former president of Wilmington Downtown Inc. And he also served as one of the members of the 2017 ad hoc Committee on Workforce and Affordable Housing, and Steve Spain was also on that committee as well. Okay, questions. My first question to the panelists is, we've all heard that housing can be a burden and a challenge for some of our families here in Wilmington. From your experience, who can afford to live here and why? And how does that also affect the larger community? So, okay. So feel free to, whoever wants to take a stab at it first.
No, I'm just kidding. So I am in the multifamily housing development. These guys are rock stars here in your community for trying to provide housing that is an ownership opportunity. And I kind of fly below the radar because a lot of folks are afraid of multifamily housing. You know, just the sound of the words coming out of your mouth can raise the hair on the backs of some people. But with the affordable housing program that I work in, I am in a very specific cog of the wheel of affordable housing. I have to competitively apply for tax credits to be able to afford that housing. Those tax credits, basically, if I'm lucky enough to get an award, last year I was lucky enough to get 2 awards, and believe me, that does not happen very often. So this year I don't think I'll get anything, but that's okay with me. I've got my hands full right now to try to get these 2 off the ground. But basically, once I receive the award of tax credits, then I take those tax credits to a syndicator, an investor, who have a group of people that make a heck of a lot of money and are looking for a tax break. And so I shop those, basically. I try to get the best top dollar price and also the best terms. And what that usually means is about 60% of the money needed to build, let's say, an $11 million property like on Piner Road, I've got about 60% of the money through the sale of those tax credits. And that's debt-free. It's money that comes in. Now I have to perform. I have to make sure that they get those tax credits and that the people that are supposed to live there do qualify to live there. So I'm on the hook. I stay with the property forever. We manage the property. But the reason I'm telling you all this is because the other 40% comes from some sort of loan, maybe a low interest loan through the Housing Finance Agency, or it might be a conventional loan through a bank, through a Freddie Mac, through, you know, some other program that understands the tax credits. And the reason I'm telling you this to try to answer your question is that it'll, by having 60% of that money basically be debt free, I can make the rents below market rents, and I can serve the folks that probably these folks cannot serve, even if they were in multifamily development, the Tribute properties. You know, they're serving people that are probably making 60% or better of area median income, and I'd probably say really even 80% or better of area median income. I'm serving people at 60% and below. I'm serving 25% of my units, probably at least, are serving people at 30% of area median income. They're living on Social Security or some sort of disability. They can't work. And so a number of my residents are hitting the very low income, and not just the low income. And the only kind of downside to this program is, like I said, it's competitive. Not every year Wilmington wins a tax credit property. Not every year I can bring 72 units, or someone else like me can bring 60 units into the community. And so that's what keeps you at a deficit in this community with serving the needs of the people that are at 60% or less of area median income. So I know that was a long answer, but kind of had to explain how we're able to do it the way that we do it with the resources we have.
Well, I'll give a real short version, which is if you're a household making less than $40,000 a year, then you have a problem affording housing here in New Hanover County. Bottom line, that's teachers, construction workers, probably about 10% of those who apply and become homeowners through Habitat come from the hospital. So these are food service workers. These are people who we work with every day, who we depend on for the life that we're able to enjoy in this county. And a lot of them are unable to live in this county. Now, Habitat for Humanity, this is damning with faint praise, but as nonprofits go, we pay quite well. But you know, nonprofits are at a different scale. About a quarter of my staff live in either Brunswick or Pender County. I can think of one individual for whom that's a choice about amenities and what he likes to farm, so he needs the land. Everyone else, it's because that's what they can afford for themselves and their family. So, I mean, that's the short answer, is really an awful lot of pin. 40,000 is about 60% of the AMI in New Hanover County. So all of those people need it. And what effect does that have? Well, like I mentioned, if you go to the hospital, you want the person there to be able to draw your blood. You don't want to wait an extra hour or an extra 3 days to get test results back. Well, the people doing that work have to often come from far away. And I'm just going to sneak this in because I don't want it to get forgotten, because I know it will for me, because this is all about housing. But we have to remember the two other big factors that play into this, which is income, which affects affordability. Obviously, the more money you make, the more that's affordable for you. And transportation, because your ability to have transportation cheaply to and from home and work also affects affordability. I don't think we're going to talk too much about that, but I don't want people to forget that.
That's a good point. And when we talk about transportation combined with housing costs, HUD typically says that if you're spending more than 45% of your income on both housing and transportation, you're cost burdened. So that's another factor for sure. Yeah.
I don't know that I have a whole lot to add. I'm in an interesting position because our firm builds some of the highest end homes in the area. We also build some of the lowest end homes. And I don't want to come across as even remotely socialist on this. I am a free market kind of guy, but we wouldn't be building the lowest priced homes if we weren't building the highest priced homes. It is not a profitable component. And even when we build the lowest priced homes, we still have to be cautious of making sure that home is built correctly. It's a lower maintenance home. The last thing you want is to be able to afford the home but not be able to afford the repairs. It's no different than buying a Maserati. It doesn't matter if can you pay for the oil change. What I think we look at a little bit more succinctly as a resident and not just as a home builder, is regionally. I have remember hearing the term, you just drive till you qualify, in the 80s. I mean, and that is no different in Wilmington, in our area. And that's not really a healthy way to grow a community. Fly into Atlanta Airport. If you've been on a Delta flight, you've flown into Atlanta Airport, and Atlanta just keeps getting, it just keeps going and going. You're like, oh, we're almost here. And then you're still in the air for 20 minutes. I mean, that's Atlanta. And Wilmington is certainly seeing an interesting ring of growth. That growth, of course, is dragging up and down Highway 17. As a community, and what I'm grateful for, not only being here, but with the leadership of New Hanover County, is it is imperative that we start acknowledging how we're going to take care of the people who are, in a lot of ways, taking care of us. Mm-hmm. It is not just the barber or the house cleaner or the service worker. There's a whole host of people who are driving a long way to go to where our wealth is, and those wealth use services and they pay for those services, but those workers have no mechanism to either easily get there transportation wise, or they're not adding to a bridge traffic or a road traffic or to anything else. And it's not free. My son, who is, he's a kid, he's 16, he's driving 45 minutes to work in a truck that probably gets 8 miles to the gallon. And I had to explain to him, now he's working on a farm for the summer and he loves it and I'm happy for him, but I'm saying, look, you're making this and you're paying this and let me see this. And it's not that he's a kid. He doesn't have any costs, but at the end of the week, what he has left over is significantly lower than his brother who is driving, who's riding a bike or driving just down the street. And so helping all of our residents understand that the cost of housing just isn't what's my monthly. The cost of housing is not only what is it costing me in transportation, what is it costing me in my time? If I'm spending an inordinate amount of time getting from one spot to the other, I'm neglecting civic obligations, I'm neglecting the PTA, I'm neglecting some quiet story time with my kids, I'm neglecting the ability to make a healthy dinner for my house. And all of those things factor in the quality of life as our community. And that's something that housing, we start with, but it's gonna solve a number of problems as we work through it.
Awesome, thank you guys, that was great. The next question is, what are the biggest roadblocks to finding stable, affordable housing for average families, and why? I think a couple of you touched on this a little bit mm-hmm. as well, the transportation and everything.
Steve, you have at it. I have two pages, so who is that? And I'll hand them out. I have lots of commentary, of course, but
I have small.
Yeah, you have.
You go first, Steve.
All right. We did talk about it a little bit. I think the biggest roadblock is the mismatch between the few areas of the county, mostly in the northern part of New Hanover County, that are affordable and where the jobs are. So, you can find more affordable housing in Castle Hayne and other parts of northern New Hanover County, but then you've got to drive in and clog up Gordon Road, like the project that we're helping to clog up by building there. So I think that mismatch is a big part of the problem. And the further you live, the higher your transportation costs. But for low and moderate to income people, it's not just like Dave said, it's not just the monthly, but it's the fact that a car is a necessity. Mm-hmm. That if you lose your car for one day, your kids aren't in school, you aren't at your job. If you lose your car for 5 days, you probably don't have a job and your kid's in serious trouble at school. So it's not just the cost of the gas, the oil, the maintenance. It's that low to moderate income people who rely on transportation to get between, private transportation to get between work and home, are taken advantage of by the necessity of having that transportation. If the car breaks down, that buy here, pay here lot is all that they got to do it. Got to have a car by tomorrow. So the one who's willing to give you a car by tomorrow, whatever the terms, you have to do that. And so that's a really critical part of this, is when people have to rely on private transportation to get from home to work, they are in such a fragile state if that car ever breaks down. I have more, but I know you guys do too.
Well, one of the criteria I have to meet to even have eligibility for a site to apply for tax credits, maybe even really a couple criteria, but the biggest one is it's a point system. The site has to score a certain number, and if you don't hit that number with your site right out of the gate, odds are you're not going to win the award anyway. So that's the first criteria. It's kind of a two application process where the first application in January looks at the market, looks at your site location. But my criteria is very specific. If I'm within 1 mile of a Food Lion or a Harris Teeter or some other Publix, and I have to be within 1 mile of a drugstore that could be inside the Harris Teeter or the Walmart or the Super Walmart, and some other type of shopping, whether it's a Dollar General, which that's easy nowadays, right? Dollar General's everywhere. I'm just kidding. I say that in jest, but it's true. But those three types of shops, I have to be right off the bat within a mile of that to get the maximum scoring. And then you start looking at, okay, where's medical? Where's library? Where's school? Where's other supportive services within the vicinity of that site? And I might not be within a mile of those, but I can capture enough of those potentially to still get a perfect score. Then you got zoning. Okay, I found the perfect site. Now how do I kind of go through the minefield of zoning or public hearings and things of that nature? So I'm kind of looking at your question kind of more of a 10,000 foot level of trying to be able to figure it out. Are we in trouble? Okay, sorry. So I'm kind of looking at it from that perspective. How do I bring affordable housing to our community? What are the first things that I have to do to be able to do that? What I do love about it, though, is it's very specific, right? And yeah, it's probably going to make the land cost very, very high. I mean, this property on Piner Road, I've paid the most than I have ever paid in combination of phases. But it also is within that mile. It puts the daycare worker within a manageable distance of their job, because I have daycare workers, I have school bus drivers, I have solid waste workers that hang off the back of the truck and wave to you on Tuesday mornings whenever they're picking up your trash. Those are the people that I house, and I'm happy to do it. I'm happy to put them closer to where their work stations are or the services are. Just think about Monkey Junction and the properties that I'm talking about that I'm involved in within Monkey Junction. Think of all the jobs that are just right there that people can walk to. The first property I did in Wilmington, which is Lockwood Village, which is on South College Road, is within a half a mile from one door of the apartment to the front door of the Walmart. And I'm on the same side of the road. So a huge advantage for a lot of my residents in Lockwood Village. So he is right, but that's what I like about our program with affordable housing on the multifamily side, is I'm usually within that mile, and I am getting wave transportation for our residents usually. And I love that the county's bringing in, you know, the multi-use trails right down College Road, or the city's doing it, but I know the county's going to pick right up and go down Piner Road.
That's a big deal.
It's a big deal. A really big deal.
I've got some other I got a list of the questions beforehand, so I kind of arranged a couple things. I don't want to jump ahead, but I started looking more and recently into the history of Wilmington as to why our community has a little bit more challenges than you'd expect. And the easy ones are, well, you're a coastal town, you're a vacation town, half of your geography is underwater. I mean, all of the things that we are already well aware of. But when I started digging back and I was talking to some developers or their dads who were developing things on what used to be a country road, it was called Eastwood. I don't know if anyone remembers. It was just this silly, you know, dark road that cut across. But the homes in there, at one time, you know, we really, as a community, we didn't build a lot of housing stock between 1955 and 1990s. And a lot of that was because no one really came here. And to get here took a long time, unless until I-40 came in. And so what was interesting, unlike a lot of communities and bedroom communities around metropolitan areas, you had various housing stock. And what happened was your first-time home buyer bought something they could afford, and the school district was usually pretty good because a lot of that area was a lot of the same age kids or whatever you might have. And then that family would start to migrate to the next house, and they had a little bit of equity in their house that they'd been living in, and they'd pay down some debt, and you could count on them bumping up their payment maybe as much as 50%. But what's interesting is, while we didn't create a lot of new housing, and if anything, in the 70s, the housing that we, 60s and 70s, the housing we created in Longleaf Acres or Pine Valley, in a lot of ways, we're also demolishing lots of housing and part of our urban areas and in areas where we would have expected to have some of that housing stock. So we don't enjoy a whole lot of older housing stock that is usually your first line of defense, because when you're trying to find affordability, you know, you'll give up some amenities. You'll give up a garage, or you'll give up, you'll give up what you, how about this? I'll frame it another way. A luxury becomes a necessity really quickly once you have a two-car garage. How do I go backwards? But my first house didn't have a dishwasher. My first house didn't have a garbage disposal. But, you know, there's no way I'm doing that now. But I think when we look at the number of homes that we should have, two things have occurred. Longleaf Acres, which was a house in 1995 for $70,000, is a half-acre piece of land on 1,500 square feet. And the homes there start at 250, and even then, while it's got 8-foot ceilings and 12 to 14 windows, and maybe it has a garage and maybe it doesn't, nobody's moving. You know why? Location's great. What is so compelling that's going to make me sell this house, which is perfect for a first-time family or with a big yard and a good school district and all those things? There's nothing so compelling that's going to make you sell that house, because where are you going to go? Where, what, name the neighborhood. You go across the street to Autumn Hall. Okay, it starts at $800,000. You're selling a 250 house. Maybe you can go to 400. You ain't going to 800. And I think that's some of the things that Wilmington has that's unique to us. Housing affordability is not unique to Wilmington. The good news is lots of communities all over the country are doing aggressive things, and much more aggressive and much more innovative than we are even coming close to talking to here. Mm-hmm. And guess what? We'll get to see what works and what doesn't, and with the beauty of knowledge, all those things will fall in our favor. But to the very one of the very first points that Julia brought up, if we don't create and obtain that housing study, if we don't understand what our lab results are, if we don't understand where we are on that scale, we don't know where to start on our health decisions, we don't know where to start on our diet, and we don't know, I mean, if I told Stephanie, hey, we are short this kind of house, and if you build this kind of house, I guarantee you'll make money, guess what she's going to do? I mean, she's gonna be like, I'm gonna build those. And unfortunately, a lot of the effort right now is either anecdotal, or it is what our banker will approve, or is what our realtor will say. What we're not doing is having a true understanding of what's working and what's not. And we have two things occurring now that's been more interesting than anything. In the 90s and early 2000s, everybody I built for were retirees from somewhere else moving here. And in most cases, they were in Brunswick County. Today, I am now seeing their children who are employed, getting a job here. Maybe they're underemployed. They want to be near mom. But I'm also seeing one of the four parents of my clients, you know, mama, who is 90-something. She's moving here. So I have this random mix of people in all these age ranges, which are all having very different places in their life that they are. They're at a very different spot, and they have very different needs. And we are lacking in a whole bunch of ways in meeting all of those needs. The good news is, as we start to meet those needs, we will start to be able to free up more housing affordability and lower income. But it's not going to come at the expense without some effort up front, which we hope to start today working toward that goal.
Yeah, I know when we have a property that's about to come online, like right now, Bennett Village, Pinery Road, I started getting calls 6 months ago, when are you going to have it open? From people who just, I don't know how they found my name and my telephone number. And when are you going to get it open? Well, I'm sorry, it's going to be another 15 months before I can even have the keys to let you in. We will start our rent-up process, you know, 4 months prior to that with qualifying applicants. But it's going to be a while. But let me tell you about the property that's just down the street that hopefully is going to open in the summer of 2019. I don't have a problem with turning folks toward my competition on the tax credit side, because literally before I even get the keys from the contractor to move folks in, I have probably 200 people that we have income qualified for our housing for 60 units or 72 units. I have 200 people that do qualify to live there, but I gotta go with who called me first and go down the waiting list and be fair about it. And I guarantee you that for 60 units or 72 units, I probably could move everybody in the first 2 weeks, but that's chaos. So we try to manage the chaos a little bit. And so we spread it out over about maybe a 2 month period. But I literally could be 100% occupied within the first 30 days. So I don't have a problem with finding people. People find me for the housing if we can just get the housing here and win the award. So that's where we are. And sometimes winning the award, I'm gonna take it another step. It means we may need to have the city, if I'm in the city or the county, participate in some way. Does that mean cash? Not necessarily. Does that mean utility extensions to properties? Probably. Does that mean, you know, relaxing fees or CFPUA fees or deferring fees? Probably. You know, that it, you just, you can't say, okay, this is the one way and the only way, and it, if the county would only do this or the city would only do, you can't do it because every property's very, very different.
And we are planning on having that study look at the different mechanisms that the county and the city can use, either on their own, because we have two different zoning codes and everything, or collaboratively, what can we do together to make it easier on you all to build more of this kind of housing.
Sure.
So, okay, next question is, okay, sometimes we hear, or we know that the development community can get a little bit of the blame for this this problem, and we hear things like, why can't developers just make houses cheaper? So, in other words, why aren't developers able to solve this problem on their own? So why can't you all, the developers, solve this all by yourselves? You know, what do you?
I mean,
you can solve anything.
This is a this is fascinating to me because again, I'll use my kids as an example. You know, why can't you buy me a new car like my friend Will's dad bought him a new car? And my answer was, I'm sorry, you're talking to me? There's no way you're getting a new car. I would never suggest to somebody that the most affordable option for transportation is to buy the newest car they can, even if they can cover the payment. If you're right out of nursing school and you're buying a 2020 Honda Accord versus a 2017 Honda Accord, and there's a $20,000 difference in price, it makes more... It's never going to make sense for new housing to be the solution to affordable housing. It's just not, at least not in single family realm. However, if housing was compelling to free up that person who has been in a first time home or in an affordable situation and is willing to sell that house and move over here, I think that's a win because it's like cash flow. You want to move those dollars or move that inventory through your system. As I mentioned earlier, it's hard though when you love the school or the district is good or this school district is better than that school district or the cost is increased. I think that what's fascinating is it would be great if developers, you know, were able to solve these problems. But the one thing with housing and builders and developers, we actually understand that if you build something and people will buy it, then that's the win. I mean, there's no benefit in being innovative if no one wants what the product is. So of course builders want to build something that a client can afford and that they can have. The challenge I've had in the last decade, and I'm not even talking about the financial crisis, I'm talking past the financial crisis, I am watching things, and this is no political statement, but building homes, it's a lot like moving furniture, just at a bigger scale. If you have one smart person and two strong people, you can move anything. You can move a piano, you can move a bureau, you can move your mom's hutch, you can move anything. Translate that to a home builder who is building, using maybe 150 people to build a house. I don't need 150 smart people. I need a handful of really smart people, skilled people, knowledgeable people, and I need a bunch of strong people. And forever, since time immortal, your strongest people were also often your lowest wage earners, and they were often your foreign-born workers. So I'm dealing in a climate right now where I can't attain any foreign-born workers. We've created a society where you are stigmatized if you choose a trade over going to a four-year college. So I'm trying to get young people who don't see working with your hands as a terrible thing. I am working in an economy where I'm not allowed to bring in guest workers or people's cousin or brother or somewhere else from another country to come and work with me. And I'm dealing with outside forces. We were pricing some aluminum rails for a project. I need to buy $40,000 of aluminum rails. I tried to order them in February. Dave, I can't give you a price on that. What do you mean you can't give me a price on that? Well, how about when you're ready for them, I'll give you a price. Well, I need to know what they're going to cost. Well, I don't know what the tariffs are going to do. I don't care about the tariffs. I mean, what are these $40,000 rails going to cost? Because guess what? If those $40,000 of rails are $48,000, I got to raise everybody's house $500. Your house is $500. Your house is $500. Your house is $500. So we deal in an environment where we are working with what we can as home builders and as developers. But let's not forget, maybe you don't know this, let me educate you. 25% of the cost of your house is regulatory requirements. If you're in an apartment, 30% is regulatory requirements. Yeah. I am building a mirror image of a building that I built last year. The new building, setting aside labor costs, setting aside tariffs, regulatory costs, and one afternoon at a TRC meeting added $85,000. the house, it's not better. You don't have lower energy bills. You don't have a better view. You don't have closer bus station. You get no benefit, but our community, our government, our state, our EPA, our federal government has mandated in a 12-month period that what worked for you in 2018 is not going to exactly work for you in 2020. And that equates to, and again, doesn't sound like a whole lot of money, but it equates to about $35 a month in rent that I have to add to your housing. And those small items are things that we're dealing with every day. As a community, and again, this is where you got me going, I gotta tell you, because I saw the note and I was like, I gotta get on this. We are going to have to collectively, and there's no silver bullet, there's a handful of things we're doing as a community, but some of the first things we're gonna have to do is we're gonna have to take away NIMBYism and look at neighbors for neighbors. I am in front of City Hall in the city of Wilmington in the spring. I see a client that we built a home for. What are you doing here? Oh, they're doing a rezoning near my house. Oh, yeah, what do you think of that? Oh, it's terrible. Oh, what do you mean? She goes, oh, we don't need more traffic. We don't need more cars. I'm going, okay. And then she goes, I go, well, how's the kids? What's going on? Because I know your son was getting married. And she goes, oh, I think they're going to move here. But you know what? They're probably going to have to live with us. They can't afford any place to live. And I'm thinking to myself, you're fighting an apartment complex in a mixed-use center, you know, a half mile from your house. And in one breath, you're going in with your shirt and your sign to say, stop the growth and no more people. Neighbors, we can't get housing affordability if we don't embrace mixed-use projects, urban redevelopment, if we don't embrace density and height. My friend Rich sent me an article this morning about Minneapolis, which was absolutely fascinating because their zoning is going to the allowing of no just single family. They're allowing up to duplex or triplex in some cases. Scary times, scary times. What if poor people move in next door? What if people who, you know, work with us, who we rely on to cut our grass, what if they live next door? How can we survive? That's the reality of the world that we're going to be in, and that's going to occur. We are dealing still in the city of Wilmington, and I give a lot of credit to Hanover County. You guys changed your code. In the city of Wilmington, I am still dealing with codes and requirements from the 60s that were blatantly inserted into our guidelines to prevent people of color and people who have low economic means from living next to people who have bigger yards, nicer houses, and taller trees and wider fences, picket fences. Those issues, when I go, hey, I want to put a garage apartment back here in an area that looks like it should have a garage apartment. I mean, if it was good enough for the Fonz and Happy Days, why can't a garage apartment go in behind this house? And I am, there is no mechanism to allow me to do that. I can put in an apartment and I can put in a garage, but can't put in a garage apartment. And I think all of those things, not to totally dominate this, but the one thing we can't do is look at the development community and say, those guys with their nice cars and their big boats are screwing it up for everybody. That's a very small percentage of the people who every day show up in our community to figure out how we create housing for our neighbors. And the first thing we have to do is work together, and it's gonna be a little bit of everything. And I could keep going, but I'm going to, we'll save it for the Q&A. I'll be in the parking lot with a soapbox and a megaphone.
Right. I think it's hard for the for sale folks to try to create, you know, find ways to create affordable and keep it affordable. I think that's the key. I mean, they can set a price today at 250 or 200 or whatever, but is it always going to be an affordable property? Because things change. You know, your school district becomes the school district to live in, and it wasn't, you know, years ago. So keeping a for sale property or project affordable is tough. I mean, you guys master it because you have the strategies for it through the Habitat for Humanity program, but generally, outside of this guy, the regular developer, I think, struggles to do it. People ask me all the time, you know, how can we do it? And really the one way is, in my opinion, is through a for lease property. A true affordable is through a for lease property that the seller always, or excuse me, the owner always has control of and can always manage the rents for it. And, you know, some are higher here, some are lower over there. That's the only real way, I think, and maybe I'm short-sighted, to control it, to have a true affordable property. I don't have that problem because, like I said, my bailiwick is this, with the tax credit program. I'm always going to be affordable. In fact, I have to sign my kids' lives away to say that even when I'm gone, they still have to make sure that it's affordable because we have this property for ever. These properties very rarely get sold and traded. I mean, there are those that will come in and buy a portfolio from you, but they're, guess what? They're an affordable housing developer or manager as well. So I've got a 15-year tax credit that I have to make sure is in compliance, but I have to sign a piece of paper that says it will remain affordable for 30 to 40 years, even beyond the tax credit period. So it will always be that way. So what am I going to do in 15 years when it's not, when the tax credits are gone and now the loans are due, right? I got to go apply for more tax credits to rehab it, to get, you know, refinance those loans. And therefore, you tack on another 30 years of affordability beyond that. So I don't really have that problem. But these guys are trying to solve it probably on a bigger scale on a for sale side.
Well, Habitat, you know, I'd love to say we've solved it, but I'll tell you how we managed to do it, because maybe it has some lessons for the next question of what the county might do. You know, most people understand that we use a lot of volunteers. We get donated materials. Sometimes we're fortunate enough to get donated land from the county, the city, and individuals give us land. And so people feel, they probably think that that's the subsidy that makes it possible for us to sell a house that's affordable to people making between $25,000 and $55,000 a year. The truth is, while all that's important and I have to sing those praises to keep all those things coming in, the single thing that makes our houses affordable over others is that we charge 0% interest. A house is affordable if it costs you half as much. And that's the impact over 30 years of 0% interest. If you have a $100,000 mortgage and you're paying a nice 4.25%, which you could get with good credit right now, over that 30 years, you'll pay $200,000 on that mortgage. If you're a Habitat homeowner, over 30 years, you will pay $100,000 on that mortgage. That's where all of that input goes. Even with the volunteers, with the material, with the land that we sometimes get, it costs us the same to build our 1,120 square foot house as it would cost Dave if he was building that house. You know, we still have to put that money out. You don't necessarily see it because we have staff that makes all of this possible that goes into that. But the single big thing is that mortgage. So I'm actually going to agree a lot with what Stephanie said, that rental is more feasible. I can see how that happens, because in a way, that's what we're doing with
that
mortgage.
But it's hard for our community to also build wealth.
Right.
And I think if being a landlord was so bad, I wouldn't do it. And but at the same time, I had two gentlemen who've been renting from me for 9 years. And I said, fellas, why aren't you buying? I mean, you're coupled, you're married, you're together. Why aren't you buying this house? I mean, you never miss a payment. You got the prettiest yard on the street. We don't want to live in a neighborhood full of renters. And I'm thinking, oh my God, you know, where do I start? And that's an interesting conversation, because everybody wants housing affordability until you give it geography. And these guys who've lived there for 9 years have the prettiest house on the street. I can't get them to buy their house, which means I can't get the person next to them to buy their house. But they have, they have paid my mortgage for 9 years, which I'm a capitalist. That's what I do. I'm not going to apologize. But I find two things that's also really interesting is I still, rates have been unreasonably low for a long time. Just put in perspective, a 0.25%, 0.25% of an interest rate, every time that increases, you are wiping out 1 million people nationwide who can qualify. So here we are with some of the lowest rates. Some are now in the threes. You got good credit, you got some financial understanding. Even if you don't have the down payment, you are in a position for no better have you ever had more affordability. If rates do rise, and they might rise, it might be another decade, but my first mortgage in Wilmington was 8.25%, and I was thrilled to get it. I mean, my mother, immediately when I told her, she was like, oh, you're lucky. I was
70%. How much was your house?
What's that?
How much was your house?
Well, my house was $68,000. It really came back down to my monthly was $426 a month, and that was fantastic. But that was also a time when, as a 23-year-old, I knew that the sooner I started paying for my, I mean, I had the financial literacy to understand that, but I think we are going to see, you know, there's no doubt that affordability isn't an important and an interesting topic. What's important is there are a lot of things that have to happen in working together, and being in a position or thinking that you can just blame, you know, the government for giving her money for free, or, you know, the volunteers who work for free, or the guy who has the shiny car. There's no person the villain. The villain is really, we're dealing with changing times. Wage growth has to kick in. Labor has to be reduced. We've got to train more skilled workers. I mean, God forbid any of you need drywall work right now. If you have a drywall repair in your house, watch a YouTube video and spend 3 days doing it yourself, because you will not get somebody to come over to do your drywall repair. And I'm speaking as personal, and I know drywall guys, and I can't get anyone to come over to fix something in my house. So that's the world we live in. I am paying a guy $50 an hour right now to adjust door hinges. I don't have a choice. I got to get it done. So we are lacking as a community in a number of areas, all of which are important and that we're going to have to work on together.
And please don't tell any of my staff you're paying $50.
Our lowest paid employee is a 18-year-old who's making $15 an hour. His skill sets include driver's license, the ability to show up around 8 o'clock. He knows how to charge and use the drill, the screw gun, the little Milwaukee drill gun, and he's a master with a broom and a leaf blower. That's his skill set, and he is making $30,000 a year. Now, I don't hate my, and he's fine, because I have no other options available to me if I need driver's license, reliability, and, you know, can you just, you know, follow just basic directions?
Okay.
This
has been
a big deal to me. I really can't.
This has been awesome.
You shouldn't have asked three walls.
I know, really. I am sorry.
Okay. Since we only have 10 minutes left, I am going to speed it a little bit along and see if we have any questions from the audience for the panelists.
Good, because your last question, you don't want to use. I mean, that's this whole sheet right here. Oh,
no. Well, if we don't have questions, we can go to that one. Or you can answer that question by way.
We're taking questions. That's great.
Yeah.
I have a question for Plantation for Dave. Your one affordable housing project in the South Side, the rent is starting at $875. I'm not sure exactly what right now is the going rate for rent in affordable housing, but that seems to be very high. I'm specifically curious about in the North Side, where your largest number of investments are, what have you done to bring affordable housing to the North Side? What would you say are your average rents in the North Side, your average cost for all of the units that are going up everywhere? You went from single family units to now putting more than one on each lot, so I assume you're going to be making more money. What have you brought in affordable housing to the North Side downtown?
Let's get something straight. There's no money in affordable housing unless you do what she does. So what I like to do is create some method of housing affordability, which also involves infill redevelopment. I mean, if you said, hey, Spatrino, you don't gotta worry about money. You gotta do something every day that you just love, that gets you out of bed and you go for it. We have an abundance of complete infrastructure, roads, gutters, sidewalk, water, sewer, trash service, overhead power, underground power, stormwater, existing stormwater, things that are super expensive on any new project. I mean, insanely expensive. We have all of that downtown. The challenges we have, though, is we have school systems that aren't well established or underperforming. We have communities that are the North Side, for example, you're talking about almost 80 to 90% rental. That is not necessarily a bad thing, but it's not a good thing, because on a street, I'll use Campbell Street as an example. I've got 18 residents on the street. I've got three homeowners. I will watch the three homeowners drag the trash cans back up, pick up the trash in the area, and I'll watch the renters throw the trash on the ground. I mean, that's nothing other than observation, but I don't want anyone to think that I am building, that I have chosen to lose money on projects. But I am very proud of the project we just finished on the South Side. It's on the corner of 5th and Wooster. And it is like a rock star for me, not because it's necessarily overly profitable, but because it was on a site that had been sitting fallow for 50 years. The South Side Baptist Church had been there, burned to the ground during the race riots in the 60s, the Sunday school's next door, and that building, which was I don't want to hurt you here, the whole site for two building pads was $80,000. I mean, for 80 units. I mean, you want to cry now? So it was a matter of choosing to invest in areas where nobody wanted to be. I mean, who's like, oh my gosh, I hope I can live on Wooster. Wooster sounds like a great street. You know what Wooster is? It's the second worst street in Wilmington. You know why? It's not the first worst, because I don't want it to feel any worse than it already should. It's a terrible street. But now I have neighbors living there, and those neighbors have freed up or have moved there. And in that rent rate of $845 or $875, guess what you get? Because I have the power to pull all my resources together. Your water's included, your sewer's included, your trash is included, your super high-speed secure Wi-Fi's included, the secure access, got some cool artwork. So you're rolling in, you got a parking space underneath. I've got all these things that give you a compelling reason to move from the place that you were paying, and this is what happened. People paying $675 and $7.25 said, you know what, I've been living here for 2 years, but I'm willing to pay an extra $100 a month because I'm already paying for cable, which is actually $60 a month by myself, and I'm paying for water, which is at least $40 a month. So not that we're trying to create affordable housing, but I'm trying to create more efficient housing. Housing where you use, I mean, let's get something straight. Home building and development, it is the least efficient business model. You can't name a more inefficient business model than building houses. There's nothing that comes close to inefficiency. But if we use some technology and we use some resources, we might be able to lower the cost, not through the baseline rent, but what that rent includes. And if you're on a bus stop, then I don't know if that answers your question, but that's one thing that we're trying to do in order to create ways to move people around and to create new housing in areas that don't necessarily contribute to traffic.
So that $875 or whatever really includes a whole lot more than just the rent.
And guess what? Your power bill in this place, because I just did a study on the power bills. I mean, we've only been 1 month, but it's been really hot. I mean, everyone's going to argue. I mean, everyone needed their air conditioner in June. My highest power bill was $46. Wow. So I've got you brand new construction. I've got well-defined, high design. And, you know, what's also nice is that building, which we expected to take almost 5 months to lease up, leased up in 5 weeks. Right. So here's the rub is our pro forma worked fine on the numbers that we started out with. The pressure was from the community as a whole going, you could be charging more. And we could be charging more. That, though, may bite me because right now there's a lot of inventory that's not on the market. There's a lot of homes that were damaged in Floyd or Florence. There's a lot of homes that are, I mean, who hasn't seen an apartment building being built anywhere in Wilmington right now? I mean, name a storage building or an apartment building that's not on a corner that's not under construction. There is going to be some ripple effect. What I want, clean, safe, and affordable. Not necessarily always in that order, but that's what we're trying to achieve in our urban development downtown. So.
I think we might have time for one more question.
Sorry about that.
So my question was specifically about whether or not you all offer some type of credit counseling or debt management along with your housing assistance. All of you mentioned the extra cost of housing, not just the monthly you pay for your mortgage or your rent, the cost of travel and transportation. If you're in a situation where you lose your car, you have to go find another one, but you don't have the credit to do that, that could compound onto the housing issue as well. So student loans, getting those debts down so you can afford a loan on to become a homeowner. Do you all offer those types of services?
It is really expensive to be poor in Wilmington. It is really. You got bad credit. You have late payments. You've got late fees. Everything is bad for you if you're poor. Everything's going to cost more if you're poor. That's not what we do. I mean, again, I build stuff, but there are a million different programs around.
Right. So in-house, I do not have a credit counselor or a person that would qualify to sit down with each of our residents, because I would love for somebody to come in and hold a class maybe once a quarter in our community building, and it, especially if we could get the draw for it. But North Carolina Housing Finance Agency, North Carolina Housing Coalition, they have either the folks in-house that can do that, or there are other programs even associated with some banks. I've got my Durham hat on for a minute, because there's a bank in Durham that does it, and they may even have some folks that reach out through some outreach and branching and
self-help.
You know, self-help credit union, that's exactly what I'm thinking of. So I don't have it in-house, but we do have the means to be able to point somebody in the right direction.
To connect people with those sometimes.
When we're asked, I mean, rarely are we asked to do it, but I'm happy to bring someone in and, you know, set up a pizza night and have somebody come talk to them. I would love to do that. And welcome it.
And that's an integral part of the Habitat program. Mm-hmm. That's why I can speak about the car costs. As soon as someone's accepted, we will accept people into our program with excessive debt that we would not be able mm-hmm. to have a mortgage with. If we can see within a year, if they work with our credit counselor to get that debt down. And the biggest thing that we see are folks who had to buy a car because they had to have it for their kids or their work. Our record so far, and sadly we break it regularly, was 22% interest mm. that someone was paying on a car loan, mm. which made their debt load just completely unsustainable. And our credit counselor works with people, and there's great stuff now using Credit Karma. I don't want to push anyone in particular, but there are apps on your phone that allow a great positive feedback loop that you pay off, you get a judgment off your credit rating, and Rhonda, our credit counselor, will say, just keep checking that. It's probably going to take a couple weeks. And then one day somebody hits their Credit Karma thing and sees their credit score go up 40 points. And they get excited and they come back, all right, how do I get another 40? And pretty soon Rhonda can get them from 21% down to 8 or 9. Also through usually a credit union. We do a lot of education on, you know, what's the best place for people who with low to moderate income who use their bank account just, you know, as a pass through, who aren't managing money, yeah. they just need to pay bills. And that's often a credit union. There are great banks here too, but when you need loans, that's part of it. And that is a huge part. We are invested in that for the obvious reason that we hold the mortgage. And so we want people to be very responsible and to understand their finances better. But there are, as Stephanie mentioned, there are other groups here who will do that. AMEZ Housing does credit counseling for anyone. They also do housing, but they will provide that credit counseling. They have a HUD-certified counselor that they're required to make available to the public. And you know, we work with a lot of, if you really want some credit counseling but don't even want a Habitat house, just apply. Because we work with anyone who applies on their credit. A lot of people we send away and say, but if you do A, B, and C, come back and see us. Yeah. Probably a quarter of our homeowners were people told to go away and work on A, B, and C, and they do, and they come back, and we can help them become homeowners.
That's awesome. Thank you guys so much for being here. We are all out of time, but could you join me in giving them a round of applause? Thank you to our panelists. And thanks to you all for being here today.